Very interesting area in quality service management again. And please think about latest modern technologies, especially as we reflect on the social media aspect. But customer insight, dialogue, and social media, customer insight. So reflect on this, how to get customer insight. Is it possible to gain customer insight without any interaction? Dialogue, how to initiate dialogue? What can be some of the challenges in dialogues, in interactions, and so on? And please, in this chapter, reflect on the conversation we had in chapter number 7 and also earlier chapters, but particularly chapter 7 because we just did it a while ago. Please reflect on that, as my intention is not to repeat the things which I feel I might have explained in chapter 7. So please ensure that you are watching the recordings in the same sequence of chapter numbers. It is a rare person who wants to hear what he does not want to hear. What a beautiful line this is. Extremely beautiful. Please reflect on that. It is a rare person who wants to hear what he does not want to hear. But if you want to give quality service, then you have to become that rare person. And that is why companies are unable to improve in various aspects, also in their service, because generally people want to hear positive things. They want to hear things which they want to hear. They don't want to necessarily hear the complaints, the negative side, the dark side. They don't want to hear it. So it is a rare person who wants to hear what he does not want to hear. So you need to build that capacity. So next time you are listening to someone say you things which you don't want to hear, of course you don't want to hear them, but try to hear them for a while. Try to see how long you can hear or listen to the things which you don't want to really listen. Other persons are criticizing you or telling you this and that without a reaction. Just listen and hear and try to build that capacity. Only then you would be able to go deep into or improve quality service. Because if you can't hear what you don't want to hear, then how you are going to listen about the aspects which people are not going to like in your service? Because it can be the case that it's not a company. It is a company, but then you are responsible for some aspect. Like, for example, UV is the organization, yes, but I am the facilitator for this course. So if there is something you are not enjoying or whatever, you will be talking with me, not necessarily UV. You will be talking with me and I will be talking with you most of the times. And you would like to take care of my concerns, which can be like participate in discussion, read the book, those type of things. And you might come to me for maybe better examples, or if something is not clear, maybe direct you to some other reading or something like that. Yeah, so together we would be. But if we are not willing to hear each other, then the overall quality can suffer. So it can be the case where you are the service provider yourself. So this ability to hear things, because, and the fundamental principle in that, I think, is that when the person is complaining, just think that it is an opportunity to make improved relationship. It is always opportunity to improve relationship. But generally people, including myself, I'm not like, it is reading things in theory is different, practicing them different. I'm still working on these things myself also. generally people, including myself, including yourself, generally we have seen that we become a little bit defensive. So that again, you know, it's on customer that what words they choose, what is the tone of their language, so many other things are involved in that. But strictly speaking, from the perspective of businesses which need to which depend on their customers, in the sense if customer is gone, nothing is left. We spoke about this concept in the first chapter. There is only one asset in the company. In your profit and loss statements and finance classes, you look at too many assets there. But as we are discussing this course, there is only one asset. And this is how your book has explained from chapter one. There is only one asset, and that asset is customer. Take care of that asset and everything will be fine. Don't take care of that asset and things will go all over the place. So these are very interesting. Social media, let me add a few things for that. Social media technologies in different countries, there can you can link it with laws and regulations also. Data in different countries, there will be different laws, regulations. What you can say on social media in Jamaica, you might not be able to say the same thing on social media in some other country. India, you might not be able to say that. Yes. And some apps which are open in Jamaica, they might not be open in some other countries. Banned apps or something. You can run some banned. Google has banned these 14 apps from Play Store. Have they banned all over or in some specific places? Chinese app banned in India. Very good. TikTok to PUBG to AliExpress. So in India, they have, so for example, TikTok, it is available in Jamaica, but it might be banned in some other countries or something like that. So you might be doing your customer interaction through TikTok. So if your consumers are in India, then you would have to think about it. And then for how long it is banned, then that is another problem. Yeah. And then there is always alternatives if TikTok users are banned, where you are going to take it. Censorships off TikTok. It's just one example, TikTok, but I'm saying any social media, you can look for other ones. It just came. So when I put banned apps, TikTok came. So that is why we are talking about it. But you can run your searches and see, you know, regulations, laws, regulations outside of the things which you already know, because I don't want to go in detail, because all of us use social media and we are familiar with the challenges and what we want to post and what we don't want to post. And companies also have social media pages. So many things which I have said in the last chapter, they are relevant for this. Of course, they are going to give you a lot of examples how they have spoken about social media. I can highlight a couple of things, but mostly I think you will be reading this chapter anyways. Social media can be employed by an enterprise in a number of ways, but we should highlight four that are highly important for an enterprise trying to build stronger customer relationship, or trying to get stronger customer insight, or trying to create consumer dialogue, or from chapter number 7, trying to increase customer-consumer interaction through social media. What are those four things? Engaging and activating the enterprise's most enthusiastic supporters to spread the word about the brand. That is number one. And if you can recall our conversation in chapter number 7, I mentioned somewhere there that many times when you will be down, it will be your consumers, customers who had good service experience from you. They might come out and say something good about you. So I did not use this word, most enthusiastic supporter, but this is what it is. Number two, empowering customers to defend the enterprise brand in times of stress and help it recover from missteps or distress. That's fine. Number three, listening in on customer conversations that involve the enterprise or its competitors. That is very interesting. Listening in on customers' conversation, because they might not be talking to you about the company, but they might be saying some things on social media about your company. You want to know what they are saying, and let's do that. You can do it, the search for any company you like. I'm going to run search for my favorite company, Star Pepsi. And this is what it is. Twitter, for example, comes up. Okay, now I want to see any complaints. Pepsi complaint. Yeah, I'm just running a search. Okay, let me go back. Let me come here. And then here I can do that. Complaint. Yeah. Okay. All right. Very good. The person has done some screenshot here. Here is why and how Amazon grocery shopping can endanger the life of your entire family. This is second incident of their product disregarding health and safety of the consumer. This time Pepsi, and they have mentioned other things, nearly sent all our family to ER. And then they have hashtagged, yes. So what is this? This is a complaint, but it is also a way to satisfy Mr. Rajat Kohli, yeah. PepsiCo, are you sleeping or what? Have you given up on your product? Poison, unhealthy, danger, all of that. Yes, this way you can look for complaints. You can do it for your own company. You can do it on Twitter, for example. Or there are other ways, but Twitter is very interesting because people do, I mentioned it in chapter number 7, that people do go and make some complaints on Twitter, and many times the complaints are answered very, very quickly or something like that. So, but it, look at this, it is good that even when I click latest, the latest one is 2018, which is like 2-3 years ago. So why there is no latest complaint? Well, Pepsi is very influential. They must have done some things to remove those complaints from the social media, and it takes a lot of money to get those things removed. A lot of money. You can run now, if you are interested, you can run searches on that. And even when it is removed, it is somewhere in the cloud. It is there, that complaint. What you post on social media, even when you delete it, like you post your picture on Facebook and then you delete it, it is deleted from your site. It is not deleted. Eventually they will delete it, but someone will look at it and then they will decide if they want to really delete it or not. So it's a possibility that they would want to keep your information for some reason. Yeah. So that is why whatever you post online, you have to think about that very carefully, because you will delete it, but it will be there. Of course, they will not, like, I don't mean they are going to share it with the world, but the possibility is there. They can sell the data or sell your pictures or whatever if the cost is good, maybe, but they won't do it, because then people will start talking about that on social media and it's not a good reputation. So generally people will not do it, but someone can view that. That is what I'm trying to say. At least someone can view that. Yeah. So That's a good example. And so listening in on customer conversation that involve the enterprise or its competitors. So Pepsi will also listen to a competition, for example, Coca-Cola. So they would have people who would have these jobs, like look at the postings on Twitter and other social media for Coca-Cola. You might be working for Pepsi, but you are just looking what is happening. What are the things customers are complaining about? Where, which markets they are doing weak, what is happening, all of that is information. You can just use internet and get good amount of information there. And then you can go and check in the market yourself. You can send some people in that market and see if those complaints are correct, not correct. And then you can maybe come with so your own strategy to beat that product of your competition in that market. So it is not just, it's very linked to other things. It is not just when you are discussing quality service, it's not just about improving the quality of your service. It is many things. For example, as you will improve the quality of your service, you would also want to expect that your the slice of your share in that segment in the market also increase. Yeah, so sales increases, you are also thinking about that. It is not just satisfying customer or consumer to improve service quality. It is many things. And listing the enterprise on customers and sometimes other volunteers to help provide service for other customers. This is very interesting concept. So the customers are giving service to other customers. There is a terminology for that. It's like you must have heard, I think, crowdfunding. So some crowd work, I think crowd service or something, they use it for that. So customers are just like you have some problem with your laptop. And you will go online and you will just put in the information, the problem you have, and then you will start seeing the forums. And you will go in that forum and there will be other consumers or buyers of that product, and they would have similar type of problem with their laptop, and they would have made some comments that, okay, this is problem happens, do this, do that. What is that? That is crowd service, I think. So customer providing service to other customers, that is very interesting. So you need to have those type of customers, consumers also, who will take the lead in these type of situation, because when the customers are talking with customers, it becomes very powerful. If it is complained, it becomes powerful. If it is a good word, it becomes powerful, because we rely on other people's feedback. We do, definitely. Like I mentioned in chapter number 7, you can revisit the recording that before buying, we look at like how this product or service has done for other customers, consumers. Now, we don't really necessarily know those people, but still it is those people we don't really know. It's like online, but still we would like to, like, if you want to buy a speaker, you're going to go online, Amazon, see what the consumer has said, and what are the drawbacks and so on. Then you will decide what your product is. We all have done those type of things. I think someone is making some comment. Yes, Melissa, Amazon has that. If you're thinking of purchasing a product, you can look at the comments of persons that purchased already. Very good. Yes, Amazon has that. And Amazon also, just to take this point further, Amazon also spends a lot of money to ensure that those comments are not spam, and they are given by original people, like real people, not fake people, because it is a separate industry where you can buy comments, you can buy likes, you can buy anything, which whatever views, buy views, you can buy those. The same way you can buy like $5 for every comment, so you will get a company. You can run a search, how to just run a search, Google search, how to buy comments online. You will be surprised what is happening. So companies like Amazon, which is a very good example, Melissa, they ensure that such comments are not there, and they have people who are looking for those things, and if some person is trying to do those things, they would take them out of the system and they will remove the comments and so on, because the credibility is the most important thing in such situation. Trustworthiness, credibility. Because if people start feeling that the comments on Amazon's are fake, they were bought, then the sales are going to go down. So it is in the advantage of Amazon that they take care of that aspect. Very good example. And of course, how innovative product ideas are going to come if you don't have engaging supporters, if you are not interacting with them, how you will improve your product. So it is not just about improving the service, quality of the service. It is also about innovation, new ideas in your service or product, whatever it is. These are because customer consumer is the real like user of your service or product. In the real world, you have tested your service or product in the lab, and you are satisfied with that, and you have done focus group and all of that before launching. But in the real world, customer is going to use it in different situations. That something goes wrong, they are the ones who would want to tell you what is wrong. So it's also an opportunity of that. Melissa is giving, I think, other examples, banks, etc. So yes, you can, sky's the limit. You can think it the way you want. Brand, this is very nice. Please pay attention. Brand building today is so different than from what it was 50 years ago or even 20 years ago. 50 years ago, you could get a few marketing people in a small room and decide, this is what our brand will be, and then spend a lot of money on TV advertising. And that was your brand. Yeah. If you as a consumer only had your neighbor to talk to, you had to believe what the TV was telling you. Today, anyone, whether it is an employee or a customer, if they have a good or bad experience with your company, they can blog about it or Twitter about it, and it can be seen by millions of people. It is what they say now that is your brand. It is what they say now. It is what they, your customer, consumer, what they say now, that is your brand. Yeah, so you have to be very mindful about this complaint and all of these things. It's a powerful tool, social media. You can take the debate to any level. Like social media in the recent past, it has shaped public opinion. Like for example, in big stakes like politics, social media campaigns and fake news and changed the sentiment of people, and they voted to someone else. The different countries, you can just Google search fake news impact on politics, what has happened. And so the point I'm making, if it can happen in politics, businesses are can be easily done like that. So it is this cell phone device which we have in our hands. It's a very powerful tool, like, you know, even for learning. Think about it, like, you can be in your, like, right now you can be in bed, closed eyes, and you have your cell phone and you are listening to what I'm saying. And I can be anywhere in the world and you are listening to me, and it is recorded. You can listen to me anytime, and not just me. I'm available to you anyways, and you can interact to me the way you want. I have no problem with that. But people who are not available to us, like me, like, I can listen to now modern brand building strategies by a professor at Harvard University. Just listen to him before coming to class and maybe say the same type of things he's talking about. Yeah. So he has prepared a lot for his session, and he has, of course, he's more well-read than I am, of course. And he has written maybe the books on this topic and those type of publication, which clearly I have not. So I can learn so much from him, and then I can improve my knowledge in a short period of time and improve your knowledge also. It's a fascinating time. Learn from other people. Same way you are not satisfied with some surveys, and you can check online globally or in the Caribbean that who is the best service provider in this category, whatever it is. And very quickly you can know who is the best, who are the service providers to be careful from, who are good ones, who are average, what are the pricing, all these things. Just click off, all you need is internet and some device, of course. So this has increased opportunities for businesses to learn and all of that, but it has also increased the opportunity for new competition to come in, like how hard it is to start some type of service online now. How hard it is, like if I give service to facilitate these type of courses, how hard it is for me to make a website and advertise myself and start doing this. As a matter of fact, you guys know, many of you know, that I have my website way before COVID. Like, even when I started 5-6 years ago, I made the website right away. That is the first thing I did, that I must have a website. And at that time I had no intention of lecturing or facilitating international market. And then I just kept on building that website, just slowly. Whenever I see something interesting or I need to include it, I would just include it there. Yeah. Of course, sometimes friends can get overwhelmed that there is a lot of information there, but I always tell them it is just for your knowledge. If you want to go deep into something, then you listen to it. Otherwise, no need to do that. The basic is doing the book, like we are doing the book right now. And I've not put anything on the website yet, because I'm just still deciding what should go in what. And this is some course which I recently started. Yes. But eventually it will also have that type of material, and it will be accessible to you. So later down, after 1 year, 2 year, you can always come back to that and see what is posted and what is not posted. So all these things. So market entry is very easy for a new person. Yeah, very easy. What to expect, what not to expect, very easy. Same way it is very easy for businesses to shut down also, because if they are not giving the right quality to the consumer is going to go to the entity where he or she is getting the right quality. So all these things you should reflect on in the context of modern world. And in chapter number 7, if you can recall, I mentioned to you that if we think that we are using a lot of social media, yes, we are using, but in the future it's going to be crazy, definitely. All these things which you see in the movies, like you are looking in the air and the screen comes in front of you and you are reading or scanning, just a screen in the air, like you see that in the movies right now, they are going to become part of lifestyles. It's just matter of time. It's just matter of time. And if you think that we are very connected to each other, and we are, and you are seeing this, like, you know, you can see like we are sitting on the table or something to eat together with family, and but everyone is on their phone. Like, yeah, I'm talking with someone and a text comes ting ting and the person is gone to the phone to see who texted the person. Like, we have seen it in our lifetime. Like 10 years ago, this was not the case, not to this extent at least. Although BlackBerry and those things were coming in Jamaica at that time, but still I'm saying it was not that much, but it is increasing. Like, and you know, there are very dark sides which I would like to discuss a little bit, although they are not mentioned in the book chapter, but I just feel like saying few things. For example, our dependability on like when we make a post, we want to check how many people liked it, how many people liked it. How many people have commented on it? How many people have viewed the thing? And from there, we are getting validation that, oh, especially in young girls, for example, the beauty, the concept of beauty, like they really depend on social media. I've seen it that they would post a picture, and if it does not get likes, which they are looking for, they are going to delete it. Although it's a fantastic picture, nothing is wrong with the picture. Because, and then everyone has their own beauty also. So they would delete it and say why, and they say, well, no one liked it, and the self-esteem and all of those things. So there are many dark sides of businesses also. You need to think about these things. But anyways, I don't want to go too much deep into that. How Zappos use social media. So it's an example, but look for your companies which you like. Sky's the limit for you. Any company, international brand, pick up few international brands and see how they go. And so for example, we were looking at L'Oreal. So because I'm thinking about it, I'm definitely at the end of the session, I'm going to spend 15-20 minutes on their website. See, these are social medias. Yeah, so five they are using: Facebook, Twitter, Insta, LinkedIn, YouTube. Yeah, Facebook, they have deactivated it. L'Oreal, the account does not exist. The account is private. No follower, no following, nothing at all. LinkedIn, the page is not found. And video, yes, they are using videos. This is what they are using. Others, they are not using. Now, if you would not have checked this, is there anyone in the session who would have thought that a company like L'Oreal would have their social media here, five, and out of five, they will only one will be in the working condition. All other are not working. Why they are not working? The question here is to ask why. The L'Oreal is not a small ordinary business. It's a very big business. Yeah, if you are not familiar with the company and the type of money they make. You should check them on their numbers on Wikipedia. Look at that. What is the revenue for 2019? Around 13 billion euros is the revenue. 30 billion euros. Their total assets are around 44 billion. Yeah. And L'Oreal is the overarching brand. There are many companies within L'Oreal which you are familiar with. Lancome, maybe Garnier, Sera, Acne Free, Ambi. Yeah, the quite big business. Yeah, quite big business. And they are not, their thing is not activated. Why? Yeah, for these same reasons. They can't just open up different platforms and then customers are writing all type of different things. They are better off not to open them and then maybe have some other strategy to take feedback. Because if some customer in Jamaica is upset with L'Oreal product and they go on L'Oreal and write it on Facebook, first of all, it is always going to be there somewhere in the cloud. It is the competition can buy that information. Second, everyone will read it. From India to USA to Australia to New Zealand to Russia, all L'Oreal people are going to read that. They cannot afford that type of thing. Just want to be careful. Don't open it. We will have some other challenge. We will have some other way. In some countries, you will see they would have opened it, like L'Oreal, maybe Canada. You can check it. Maybe the links are working. I don't know. I never checked. So this was a practical demonstration of how companies view social media and what it is. Yes, it is a very powerful tool, but even companies like these, they use it. They want to use it and they don't want to use it. You have to really think about these things. Like social media presence is a very positive thing, but it can really, really become negative also before you know. Yeah. Think about these things. Very thought-provoking. So I was saying that select your own company and look how they are using social media. I told you my plan. I will do investigation on L'Oreal. You don't need to do it on it. You do it on somewhere else, and maybe in some session all of us can maybe come together, or you can exchange what we learn from different companies. It's a possibility. We can do that. Okay, here are some examples. They have mentioned examples. You can look it up. Okay. Building trust now is what will save a company when they make an error in the future, which everybody will sooner or later. So in my career of facilitating classes, of course, there will be some point where I will make some blunder, I will make some error, something will happen. So for that time, I need to engage you guys in this way that are 15 people here, at least one of you I have such good relationships with that when I make blunder, that person is going to come out and going to say, Tashfeen did not mean it. He meant this. Or do say something which is going to ease off the tension or something like that. This is very, very, very important for to ensure quality service, because no matter how good the quality of your thing is, you are going to make some blunder. Okay, Lewis is saying, not sure if I'm looking forward to that tech future. All right. Well, it is coming. It is up to you if you want to live long, very, very long, which I hope you will. Then you will have to see it. Yeah, we are already there. You go to different countries. Adoption rate of technology is very different in different countries. So, but I understand the sentiment. It's too much technology and too much technology. So yes, not it's not for everyone. Let's read this. Just when it looked as if no one anywhere would step up to JetBlue's defense, someone did. Who? The company's most frequent flyers. These were the folks who month in and month out had been treated decently in the past by JetBlue. Actually, a good deal more decently than other airlines were treating them. These customers knew that JetBlue's intentions were good and they trusted in the airline's ability to make it better next time. They believed the company's apology applauded the remedial steps and came to the blogs themselves to join the discussion and defend the young airline's reputation. This is when the JetBlue was maybe coming out. Notice that there is an important trust implication in this story about JetBlue. You cannot buy trust equity from customers. You cannot. You cannot. Yeah. Or can you? The book says you cannot buy trust equity from customers. I'm going to come back to it. You have to earn it every day, of course. When customers lost trust in JetBlue, there was nothing beyond their own positive action JetBlue could do to rebuild it. Only their customers could do that because of the trust JetBlue had already built with their customers in the past. Very interesting example. But you know, the way I read it, I'm reading the book, of course, this is written by top scholars, a lot of experience. They have more experience than my age. They are very experienced, not just one book. They have written multiple books they have written. So I'm not in any position to, you know, dispute any claim which they make, but this is how I read. Anything I read, I'm also asking myself if it is true or not, although sometimes I'm reading fast, but this is my habit. So when I came to this line, although you can see I have not even highlighted this section, you cannot buy trust equity from customers. So just my mind is asking me that, can you buy trust? So I leave that question on your, for you to think about in your own time. Reflect on it. The book has very clearly said, at least for this example. Of course, they are talking about JetBlue and you need to consider and read the things they have said before also. But I want you to think about this whenever you have time, whenever you are interested, not just in this semester, whenever. That can you buy trust from customers or not? Think about it. Can we buy trust of someone? Think about a person who does not trust you. What can you do to buy their trust? Is there anything you can do? And buy is not just by money. Different currencies. Yeah. It's a very interesting thing to reflect on. Okay, so Lewis is saying you cannot buy anyone's trust. trust always has to be earned. So she agrees with what the book says. You have to earn it every day. Yeah. This is what Lewis thinks. Yeah. And of course, the book is saying it. So I have no problem with that. But personally speaking, I can be wrong, but I think that no offense to anyone, you can have your own opinion. But my opinion is, and my observation and experience is that if you have the resources to buy, you can buy anything in life. Of course, this is a very controversial statement. But I think that we can buy someone's trust over a period of time. Not just giving them money, but maybe something else which they value. Maybe they don't value money, so they won't be get bought by money. There must be some other thing which you can give them. But that is just my personal opinion. The book does not say that. The book says what our friend Lewis has said. You cannot buy anyone's trust. Trust always has to be earned. So that is it about that. Yeah. Okay, yes, very interesting. If you buy it, it is not real. All right, very good, Lewis. It is just like, you know, can we buy love or not? Of course, we cannot buy love. But can we buy love which is not real? Yes, we can buy love for the night or for the little duration. We can buy love. It is not real, but what is the difference between it's you get what you want. You want, why you want to really think if it is real or not? You get what you want. Maybe that. So nice, very interesting. Different people think differently. But most people think that yes, love cannot be bought. Personally, I don't think that. I think anything can be bought. I think love can be bought. But of course, you guys would not think that, which is good. You are good human beings. You are not going to try to buy those type of things. You will earn it. You will earn the love and you will earn the trust. Yeah. Keep in mind that listening, as we describe the process here, does not occur just once. It needs to occur continuously over months and years. And that is the right way to, you know, go about it. Listening to customers, yeah? So it's not the case you listen one time and then you go away. No, it is continuous process. You cannot say that I have listened to those customers and I'm not going to listen to them again because they are repeating the same things. No, they will be repeating the same thing, but every now and then they are going to come up with something. So it is a continuous effort, continuous. And everything in life is continuous. Like everything in life, you have to earn it over a period of time, generally speaking. It takes time for things to, anything you want to build your career, is not going to happen overnight. That only happens in the movies. Like it's a 2-hour movie and in that the person is from rags to riches type of story. That is only in the movies. In the real life, generally speaking, people take time and step-by-step procedure, and same goes for understanding customers. It will take time to understand customers, and if you use other mechanisms to understand them or buy them, then it will not be the real thing. But you know, trust is something which, okay, you can spend years and years to build the trust, but then you will do one thing and that real trust which you have built is gone. Where is that trust gone? Like, for example, Honorable Bill Gates, how long was his marriage? 30 years, 40 years? How did they build the trust together? Slowly, step by step, very good. And it was real, yes, it was real. Long-lasting marriage, of course. So what happened to that trust? Honorable Bill Gates got involved in a couple of things here and there. And that trust is broken and the partnership is over. Just like that. So this is how it is. So with that context, what is real, what is fake? No one really knows. Especially I don't know. So don't listen to me. And I also would like to say that maybe you also don't really know. What we know is just the way we are brought up and the things we have listened to. They influence us and then we become what we are. But if we think about it, the things we say is a collection of things which we heard from different people and from different books. So it depends on what type of people you are listening to and what type of things are coming in your experience and so on. They are going to shape your thinking about customers and your business and quality and how to improve it. You read some other book on quality service management, it is going to talk about some other things maybe. Fundamentally, the things are same, but things change with the examples, with the type of examples people give. What are the pain points being highlighted by customers? These are some of the things you might want to think about. Are they legitimate concerns? Are they directed towards the company at large? Or is something being said about a particular situation or individual? When monitoring these comments, the enterprise should never dismiss customer rants just because they are emotionally charged. This line is so important because we do dismiss the rants people make. When monitoring these comments, the enterprise should never dismiss customer rants just because they are emotionally charged. So even in your own life, when some friend or family member or anyone is emotionally charged and they are saying what they have to say, don't dismiss those things just like that. Yeah, all critical comments, 100% of them should be checked out to ensure no underlying issue exists. Generally, we don't do that in our life. Yeah, we say, oh, this, that was not necessary, it was just rant. But every line, every comment made by customers or the people you engage with, because they are also your customer in that time and space, you are giving them something and maybe they are not happy about it and they are doing some emotional rants. 100% of them, all critical comments. But because we don't like critical comments, that's why, you know, we become defensive and so on. Even when a customer gets the facts wrong, the perspective or impression still can be valuable. Even when a customer gets the facts wrong, yeah? They might be just putting some type of allegations on your company. Still, the perspective or impression still can be valuable, because many times when people are complaining and those things, there are underlying issues. They might get angry now and you might not understand why they are getting angry now, but it can be the case where in the past many of their needs were not met, they were not serviced properly, and that thing kept on adding, and one day they just go out of proportion. These things happen. I'm sure you have experienced those type of things in your in your personal life, in your the way you interact with your friends and family and dear ones. Even when complaints picked up in social media can also help point out potential unmet customer needs. So even if it is they are just shouting and yelling and using bad, inappropriate words, you need to look for underlying things, why they are saying that. Try to understand that. And that is if you want to give quality service. And most people don't want to do that. When someone is making some bad comments, they want to walk away from the situation or give them a shut up call, something like that. But based on the way we are looking at the readings, they are saying that those are the opportunities for you to understand the customer better. And the better you will understand your customer, the better you will be able to service them, because you have listened to their emotional rants and all their allegations and wrong facts, which your competition did not, because they got bored of listening to those rants, or they felt disrespected, or whatever the reason is. So now you have been listening to them and you now understand the customer better. So all that information is going to help you serve that customer better, theoretically speaking at least. Of course, there are customers hard to please. No matter what you do, they are going to find something which you did not do, and that is it. Social media can alert a company to a potential product or service issue faster than any other chat channel. Yeah. Still, L'Oreal has deactivated 4 of its social media apps out of 5, only YouTube working. L'Oreal International. Yeah. Fast. So you will know fast, you will have to react fast also. Yeah, if you can't react fast and you can't, you are focused on other things in your business, then maybe so we looked at some of the positives, some of the negatives. Yes, crowd service. This is what it is. The term I think I mentioned earlier, when the customer complaints are, or customer inquiries are addressed by other customers, which are maybe no more knowledgeable or maybe more willing to help the business, like, that is, that concept is called crowd. We all of us had heard about crowdfunding. We have heard about crowdfunding, but crowd service can be a new term for you if this is the first book you are reading on quality service. Yeah, they have given some interesting example here. I enjoyed reading it. Very nice. I could read it, but you guys read it. Very interesting. It is worth reading. This is an example. Pay attention, please. In a Business Week interview with Frank, the Comcast employee who initiated his own responsibility for handling customer issues via Twitter, Frank made it part of his job to help customers with problems they brought to him on Twitter. One day he mentioned on Twitter that he would not be available the next day to help customers. When he returned the following day, he expected to catch up on all the customer complaints he had missed out on. To his surprise, he found that some of the Comcast customers following him on Twitter had taken it upon themselves to reach out to other customers and ask if they could help. They even used Frank's trademark, "Can I help?" as the first outreach to customers who required assistance. Frank said to the article, "That day I understood the effectiveness of what we do, every company could learn that same lesson. Customers who feel connected to a brand will become advocates even when the brand is a hated cable company. In this case, customers were not out promoting the brand to their friends, but they were spreading goodwill by clearing up problems that otherwise would have created animosity towards Comcast. Did customers in this case help because they were loyal to Comcast or because they were loyal to Frank? The hope is that they associated Frank with the brand and had become loyal to both Frank and Comcast. A very interesting example. Are you, look into your own lives, are you connected or linked at that level with some company where you will go out and see what complaints people have made for that company and you address them? Yeah, that would be interesting. Give and take. Why Helping Others Drive Our Success? Very interesting book to read. Of course, you are not going to read this book, at least now, but whenever you get time, I think, or interest, just what I'm trying to say, get into the habit of reading books every now and then when you have, you know, even half an hour every day, 15 minutes every day. Over a period of time, a lot of knowledge can be acquired. If you have less time, then you have to be more selective of which book you are going to read, but please. And nowadays you can listen to book, audio books. Yeah, if you don't want to read, that is fine. You are driving, audio book is on, you are listening, you are in bed, trying to sleep, audio book is on. You can easily go through 5, 6, 7 pages in a day, even if you are very busy. So every month you read 2-3 books. In a year you have read 25 to 30 books. That would be very nice. Yeah, but all of that is wishful thinking. At least read this book for within the semester. That would be a good start. Yeah, and I'm sure if you are reading the book, you will agree that you are learning many things which are reflecting on many things which you might not have if you would not be reading. Okay, one important key to social media is what the authors call 1-9-90, which describes how to visualize the ratio of contributions different participants will make in an online social community. They are saying out of 100 people, if you have 100 people, how many people will participate in an online environment? They are saying about 1% of the population post. 1% will post, about 9% respond to the post, yeah, and 90% just read the post. Yeah, and that explains our interaction on this online forum. How many of you are making comment? How many are making some response to the comment? How many of you are not doing anything? No comment, no response, no voice, nothing at all. Yeah, so it is the same. You will see that it is just the nature of online, you know, communities. This is what happens. 1-9-90 rule. 1% post, 9% respond to the post, 90% just read the post. Two things are very important for this. Two things are important to understand about the 1-9-90 dynamic. If you want a vibrant online social community, you have to invite the people who will drive the conversation. So you must ask yourself, have you invited this 1% which is going to make comments? That is how you publicized the community in venues where these 1%ers can be found, and will your community be attractive for them, you may also need a community manager to help other participants in the conversation. And second point is just as important, you must realize that for 90% of your community's population, engagement might not involve actual participation. So those of you who are not commenting or talking or something, it does not mean that you are not engaged. Maybe you are engaged, you are reflecting, you are thinking. In this time, you just want me to talk. Whatever is your reason. And maybe you are, as I'm saying, you are thinking about these things and making your own judgments about all the things I'm saying and discarding the things which you don't really like and accepting the things which you maybe like or make sense to you based on your experiences and so on. So it does not mean those 90% who are not saying anything are not involved. Don't mistake lack of actual conversational input as lack of interest. It also does not mean that those who are not saying anything are not interested, but their interest levels can be different. These people still read, they consider, they think, and they use the information you have in the community to make decisions, to make recommendations, to solve their own problems and so forth. Authors have worked with companies that when they see just 10% of registered users posting or responding, wonder if the effort was really worth it. But you have to remember, if someone comes to a party and just hangs out, never even opening his mouth, he still must be enjoying it in some way. Otherwise, why would he come to the party at all? So all of you 13 people, you at least came to the party. Yeah, so to have that sentiment that everyone is going to participate, you can increase the participation rate by using some tactics and interact with your customers and learn about them. But it will never be, maybe it will never be 100%. Now think about some examples where companies are able to interact with their customers 100%. If there is any such company, you can email me about that. This section is also very important, all of this. I made a note that I can read this non-highlighted section, but I want you to read this in your own time. It is interesting and important. But anyways, please don't think that you are just, I've mentioned it a couple of times, but I can mention again. You are reading the book cover to cover, chapter from first page to the last. Yeah, that is what you are doing. Many interesting examples are here. You can read those examples. Think about your own examples, reflect on them. It's again very interesting book to read, Wealth of Networks, How Social Production Transforms Markets and Freedoms. Yeah, very interesting book when you have time. And the book is talking about many things, and there are two things, economic standing and social standing. Very interesting. These rewards are understood as instrumental and in this regard are highly amenable to economics. Both economic and social aspects represent standing, that is, are relational measure expressed in terms of one's capacity to mobilize resources. One is economic, one is social. Some resources can be mobilized by money. Social relations can mobilize others for a wide range of reasons, institutional, cultural, and possibly technological. Some resources are more readily capable of being mobilized by social relations than by others. They are talking about two different currencies, economy, money, and society, social standing. If you want to get your nephew a job at a law firm in the United States today, a friendly relationship with the firm's hiring partner is more likely to help than passing on an envelope full of cash. If this theory of social capital is correct, then sometimes you should be willing to trade off financial rewards for social capital. And it is very interesting. It came here, and maybe that is the reason I was saying that you can buy anything. You can buy love, you can buy trust, not just through your economic standing. There are other currencies which you can use, and maybe your social standing. Whatever you are in the society, you are very influential or something like that. And of course, as your quality of service is going to improve, you are going to venture into international markets, and you will gain more, you can gain better reputation and financial security and also visibility in international markets. Eventually, you will become very powerful, so you will gain some type of social standing. So then there are things which you can do to gain the trust of different governments, and they give you different type of incentives. These are some things which I generally discuss in international business management. You can go. The things are posted for that course also online, so feel free to go through that if you want. But I doubt if you will have that much time on your hand. The more interacting we do, the more transparent things will inevitably become. From WikiLeaks and the Arab Spring to a cable TV repairman asleep on your couch or an airline's luggage handler's mistreating bags, people will find things out because of social media and all of these things and our connectivity. So these were some things you might want to reflect on. Of course, many examples they spoke up about Arab Spring. I gave you earlier example of politics. Let's look at this example. Samsung faced a lawsuit in Taiwan and significant fines when the company was accused of hiring students in South Korea to post negative reviews of a competitor's product and positive comments about its own. Samsung did that. When the deceit was sniffed out, as it so often is, Taiwan Samsung felt compelled to make a public apology on Facebook, reaffirming its values of honesty and transparency. So this would be a very good case for you to look at what are the things Samsung Taiwan did to repair trust. Because every now and then we are going to break our trust. What are the things we need to do after? Because Samsung still is a valuable brand. As a matter of fact, a lot of us own some of their product, a phone or something else. So what did they do? How did they go about to repair trust and ensure that they are honest and transparent in the eyes of consumers? You would have to do some research on that. Posting positive book reviews for a fee has become a lucrative business for many, as favorable reviews boost sales for authors. One provider of fraudulent reviews was eventually exposed by an angry customer who posted a negative review of his service, saying he did not produce the quality of review she felt she deserved for her money. Consequently, Google took ads for the reviewer service off its sites. And Amazon removed his reviews from its database. From the database, Amazon removed. Yeah. So that tells us, just this lines tells us that review does not just go on the website of Amazon, it also goes into their database. So if you are reading carefully, you will pick up that anything you post online, it is going into some type of database where the company does not always remove all the things. Very interesting. The problem, however, continues to loom large. Bing, a researcher at the University of Chicago who is working on a program to detect illegitimate reviews, estimates 1/3 of all consumer reviews on the internet are fake. 1/3. My God, what is going on? Yeah. And they have referenced their research properly, so you can always check the reference and so on. Today, we are just scratching the surface of consumer to consumer interaction. In 15 to 20 years, Moore's law suggests there will likely be 1,000 times as many product and service reviews and 1,000 times as much information content, from news articles to blog posts and Twitter trends. And 15 to 20 years after that, we will have 1,000,000 times as much as today. So service applications that get the jump on helping customers benefit from social filtering are likely to see a strong competitive advantage within just a few years, because we will all be relying more and more on our friends' opinions for help. This will be very exciting in the future. It will be part of a trusted relationship in the long run and part of the customer experience in the short run. If a company wants to influence social sentiment, but in a trustable way, forget sock puppeting and instead start by trying to think about what actually motivates an influential blogger or Twitter user, someone whose opinion matter to thousands of followers. Yes, most key influencers would be offended if you offered to compensate them for a favorable post, but they are still human beings, and like all the rest of us, they have ambitions too. So they are talking about, you know, influencers and those people, you engage them, and not just through finance, but maybe you through other means, your social standings or whatever they want. You can give them what they want, and then they would want to write good things about you. Influencing the influencers, this is what it is all about. This section, above section, which I read just a bit ago. So how to influence the influencers, these people who have a lot of following on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, and so on. When they post something, a lot of people read those things and follow them and want to have similar things, products, lifestyles, and so on. So how to influence those influencers? So they say good things about your service. In this section, they have made some suggestions for that. Please pay attention to them. Of course, in your own time, very useful suggestions are there. Before customers connected, advertising ruled. Now that customers talk to each other, it is the customer experience that counts. So before the time when customers were connected through technologies, advertising was ruling. Now that customers talk to each other, it is the customer experience that counts. Quality service management, want to look at customer experience at every stage from start to finish. The more you can understand the customer, the better you might be able to serve them. Successful marketing today requires a much higher standard of trustworthiness and transparency. Much higher standard trustworthiness. Yeah, that is why I asked you to look into Samsung Taiwan. Check how they repair trust. If you are not interested in that company, you can look at any other company which might have breached trust issues. And the idea is to understand what strategies can be used and so on. Yeah. So I hope you will think about these things. Very interesting areas to reflect on. Customer insight, creating dialogues, maybe through social media. Read things, modern things, like what is the future of social media, how companies will be improving the quality of their service in the future. Read that. Run some Google searches, read it. If you find something interesting, please ensure that you share with me via email. That's it. Thank you very much.